This past Sunday, we talked about speaking up. Speaking up was the title of our conversation. We read this passage: "Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly, defending the rights of the poor and needy." This was actually 2 Sundays ago. Now that I think about it, I was out of town this past Sunday, and when I post this, it could have been months ago, but it happened to be during the Kavanaugh issue, when everybody was fighting over whether or not Judge Kavanaugh should be confirmed. And so it's interesting that during that conversation on a Sunday morning where anybody was free to talk, we never once said the word Kavanaugh. But we spoke about this passage: "Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly, defend the rights of the poor and needy." I ask, what does it mean to speak up? And we chatted a little bit about that. I ask, what are the dangers of speaking up? And people used words like, you might take a bullet, you might get judged, you might get all kinds of anger spoken towards you or against you. You might have some people unfriend you on Facebook when you speak up. We talked about why someone wouldn't be able to speak up for themselves. And when we did that, we talked about people who were handicapped and people who were mentally handicapped and people who were maybe in a race. Maybe they're black or African American in the United States today, and that might be a person who wouldn't. It's not that they wouldn't be able to speak up for themselves, but we need some other people to speak up for folks like. Maybe a different race or an LGBT, lesbian, gay, transgender, folks like that. Maybe we need to speak up for them. But we need to speak up for the poor and needy. What does destitute mean? Now, we looked up this word destitute, and it means destruction, passing away, vanishing. So maybe this is the elderly. Maybe we need to add the elderly to this conversation. What does destitute mean? Who is destitute? So we need to speak up for the rights of unborn babies, refugees, women, various ethnicities, LGBTQ, victims of sexual assault. We have to speak up for people who are in a situation where they find themselves to be destitute. What does it mean when we say poor? The word poor just means in want, needy, chiefly needy. And so we have to speak up for the poor. What does it mean to be needy in this context? It's weak, afflicted, humble, wretched. We talked about that. And then we read this passage. And there's a lot of words in this passage that I'm going to do a terrible job of pronouncing. But I think we should hear this passage, this story at this time, and just ponder it for a moment. So sometime later, this happened. Absalom, David's son, had a sister who was very attractive. Her name was Tamar. Ammon, also David's son, was in love with her. Ammon was obsessed with his sister Tamar to the point of making himself sick over her. She was a virgin, so he couldn't see how he could get his hands on her. Amnon had a very good friend, Jonadab, the son of David's brother Shemaiah. Jonadab was exceptionally streetwise. He said to Amnon, "Why are you moping around like this day after day? You are the son of the king. Tell me what's eating at you." "In a word, Tamar," said Amnon, "my brother Absalom's sister. I'm in love with her." Emotions are tricky and easy to manipulate. Beware, beware. You can't see the word beware there, but that's it. Beware. "Here's what you do," said Jonadab. "Go to your bed and pretend you're sick. When your father comes to visit you, have my sister Tamar come and prepare some supper for me here, where I can watch her and she can feed me." So Amnon took to his bed and acted sick. When the king came to visit, Amnon said, "Would you do me a favor? Have my sister Tamar come and make some nourishing dumplings here where I can watch her and be fed by her." David sent word to Tamar, who was home at the time, "Go to the house of your brother Amnon and prepare a meal for him." So Tamar went to her brother Amnon's house. She took dough, she kneaded it. She formed it into dumplings and cooked them while he watched from his bed. But when she took the cooking pot and served him, he wouldn't eat. Amnon said, "Clear everyone out of the house." And they all cleared out. Then he said to Tamar, "Bring the food to my bedroom where we can eat in privacy." She took the nourishing dumplings she had prepared and brought them to her brother Amnon in his bedroom. But when she got ready to feed him, he grabbed her and said, "Come to bed with me, sister." a good test for yourself, just want to know if what you're doing is right or wrong, is if you don't want anyone to know what you're doing, if you want to clear out the house, if you don't want anybody to know what you're doing, it's possible, it's likely that this is a mistake. This is something you shouldn't be doing. No, brother, she said, don't hurt me. This kind of thing isn't done in Israel. Don't do this terrible thing. Where could I ever show my face? And you'll be out on the street and in disgrace. Oh, please speak to the king. He'll let you marry me. But he wouldn't listen. Being much stronger than she, he raped her. No sooner had Amnon raped her than he hated her, an intense and immense hatred. The hatred that he felt for her was greater than the love he had for her. Get up, he said, and get out. Physical strength is not a virtue, but the ability to control it and use it for good can be. He'll love me forever if I let him is a lie. It's totally false. He may actually hate you for letting him. Oh, no, brother, she said. Please, this is an even worse evil than what you just did to me. But he wouldn't listen to her. He called for his valet. Get rid of this woman. Get her out of my sight. And lock the door after her. The valet threw her out and locked the door behind her. She was wearing a long-sleeved gown. That's how you know virgin princesses. That's how virgin princesses used to dress from early adolescence on. Tamar poured ashes on her head, and she ripped the long-sleeved gown, held her head in her hands, and walked away, sobbing as she went. Oh, no, brother, she said. This is a worse evil. I can't say this strongly enough. Putting out isn't key to keeping a boyfriend or girlfriend. It could be the opposite. Her brother Absalom said to her, has your brother Amnon had his way with you? Now, my dear sister, let's keep it quiet. A family matter. He is, after all, your brother. Don't take this too hard. What stupid, stupid words. Tamar lived in her brother Absalom's home, bitter and desolate. King David heard the whole story and was enraged, but he didn't discipline Amnon. What? David doted on him because he was the firstborn. Absalom quit speaking to Amnon, not a word, whether good or bad, because he hated him for violating his sister Tamar. The people who love you most will often give you bad advice in sensitive situations. Beware of fear and don't take counsel from fear. This is counsel from fear, keeping it quiet, not taking it so hard. 2 years went by. One day, Absalom threw a sheep shearing party. Beware of sheep shearing parties. Bad stuff happens at sheep shearing parties. In Bel-Hazor, in the vicinity of Ephraim, and invited all the king's sons, and also went to the king and invited him. Look, I'm throwing a sheep shearing party. Come, bring your servants. But the king said, no, son, not this time, and not the whole household. We'd just be a burden to you. Absalom pushed, but David wouldn't budge. He did give him his blessing. Then Absalom said, well, if you won't come, at least let my brother Amnon come. Uh-oh. And why, said the king, should he go with you? But Absalom was so insistent that he gave in and let Amnon and all the rest of the king's sons go. Absalom prepared a banquet for a king. He instructed his servants, look sharp. When Amnon is well into sauce and feeling no pain, I'll give the order, strike Amnon, kill him. And don't be afraid. I'm the one giving the command. Courage, you can do it. Then Absalom said, never drink at a sheep shearing party. Absalom's servants did to Amnon exactly what their master ordered. All the king's sons got out fast as they could, jumped on their mules, and rode off. Absalom killed all the king's sons. That they said Absalom, it was a rumor. They said Absalom killed all the king's sons. Not one is left. The king stood up, ripped his clothes to shreds, threw himself on the floor. All his servants who were standing around at the time did the same. Rumors are often exaggerated, However, despite the thought that rumors are often exaggerated, you can also typically assume that rumors came from somewhere, meaning something typically sparked the rumor mill. And while it could be totally different, there's a root of some kind. There's something to that rumor. It may be totally different. It could be odd. It could be totally off the wall. It could be opposite of what the rumor says, but there's probably some root. It started somewhere. Absalom fled. Just then the sentry on duty looked up and saw a cloud of dust on the road from Horonam, wherever that is, alongside the mountain. He came and told the king, I've just seen a bunch of men on the road coming around the mountain. She'll be coming around the mountain. Then Jonadab exclaimed to the king, see, it's the king's sons coming, just as I said. He had no longer said the words than the king's sons burst in loud laments and weeping. The king joined in, along with all the servants, loud weeping, many tears. David mourned the death of his son a long time. When Absalom fled, he went to Tamala, son of Amadou, king of Geshur. He was there 3 years. The king finally gave up trying to get back at Absalom. He had come to terms with Amnon's death. Nobody will miss me is a lie. It's a lie. If there's somebody out there today saying, I'm just going to kill myself, nobody will miss me. That's a lie. Somebody will miss you. True love is indiscriminate, meaning nothing you could ever do will make God's love for you less, and nothing that you could ever do would make God love you more. Your life has meaning. We must speak up. We must speak up for victims. When you speak up, you'll be accused of hatred and divisiveness, sometimes by the people you love. When you speak up for all the oppressed and all victims, you'll find yourself on everyone's wrong side. We must encourage no one to keep quiet. We must support anyone who reports. So in this Me Too time, in this Me Too movement time, this is what I have to say. We must support anyone who reports. I'll say real quick in closing, there's a lot of debate and questions about whether or not Ford came forward as some kind of plan or scheme or lie of the Democrats. I'm neither Democrat nor Republican. I don't have a dog in either one of those fights. I believe that we are moving towards and living in the kingdom of God, not the kingdom of the U.S. government or the Republican Party or the Democratic Party. I think both Republican and Democratic presidents and leadership and groups have been part of killing too many people with drones and wars. And so I'm opposed to both parties. I'm opposed to both ideas. I'm opposed to everything that is antithetical to the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is a kingdom of love and peace and open gates and bigger tables. And that's what I'm all about. So don't get in your mind that I'm a Democrat or I'm a Republican. That's not true. It has no element of truth. However, I am very much in favor of supporting people who report. We must not keep quiet. We must encourage and speak up for the oppressed and the victims. If somebody comes out and tells you that they're a victim, they've been harmed, they've been hurt, we got to step up and speak up for them any way that we can, however we can. We help them, we support them. And that's my message, that's my thoughts today. Don't keep quiet.